Sinds de eurocrisis zijn ze niet meer weg te slaan uit het nieuws. De rating agencies, ofwel kredietbeoordelaars.
Goedemorgen, kredietbeoordelaar Moody's.
Kredietbeoordelaar Standard & Poor's. De Ieren zijn boos op kredietbeoordelaar Moody's.
Standard & Poor's heeft de kredietwaardigheid van Griekenland.
Kredietbeoordelaar Moody's
heeft de kredietstatus van Frankrijk verlaagd. Die gaf het land gisteren de junk-status.
Rating agencies lijken tegenwoordig de dienst uit te maken op financieel, economisch en dus ook politiek terrein. Ieder nieuw oordeel uit hun koker zaait angst en paniek en brengt landen en burgers aan de rand van de afgrond. Maar wie zijn ze nou eigenlijk? Dit is wat u te wachten staat.
Nós vivemos uma guerra, é uma nova guerra, não é feita com exércitos, mas é feita com outros instrumentos.
These are very powerful companies. Very powerful companies.
Oh, I've had him say, if you downgrade us, I'll lose my job.
Vanavond, alles over de macht en onzin van de rating agencies. U kijkt naar Tegenlicht. Welkom in uw toekomst.
Vendredi, une agence a fait perdre le triple A. Lundi, une agence confirme que la France garde le triple A. Deux agences sur trois. Il faut réagir à ces décisions avec sang-froid.
Het gezicht van de Franse president Nicolas Sarkozy spreekt boekdelen. En hij is niet de enige die verbijsterd is door de plots onbegrensd lijkende macht van de kredietbeoordelaars. Tot voor kort deed zelfs de financiële sector nog laconiek over de rol van de rating agencies. Ex-beurshandelaar Dirk Müller herinnert zich de naïviteit van zijn collega's in Frankfurt nog levendig.
Als ich vor etwa drei Jahren mal hier eine große Frage bei vielen an Kapitalmarktteilnehmern in Frankfurt gestellt habe, weißt du eigentlich, wer hinter S&P, wer hinter Moody's steckt, wem die gehören, wer da hinten dran steht, wo diese Ratings herkommen, habe ich von allen nur gehört, keine Ahnung, damit hat sich keiner beschäftigt. Man hat Milliarden Entscheidungen auf diese Ratings gegeben, aber niemand hat gefragt, wo diese Ratings herkommen. Man hat die als Gott gegeben angesehen, als von oben, vom Herrgott, als neutrale Instanzen angesehen. Dass das private amerikanische Unternehmen sind, danach hat keiner gefragt, das wollte keiner wissen, das hat keinen interessiert. Das hat sich heute geändert.
Gut, even voor de beurshandelaren in Frankfurt. Er zijn drie grote kredietbeoordelaars. Moody's en Standard & Poor's zijn de grootste. Fitch Ratings is wat kleiner.
You know, it's not a shock, obviously, but it's they're talking about one notch downgrade, so that'll be.
Tegenlicht zoekt uit wie dat nou zijn, kredietbeoordelaars, en hoe hun rol zo groot kon worden in het internationale financiële systeem, met alle politieke en sociale gevolgen van dien. We gaan op bezoek bij Jerome Fons, die 17 jaar lang bij Moody's werkte. Bij Reggie Middleton, investeerder en schrijver van de website Boom Bust Blog. En bij Timothy Sinclair, hoogleraar politieke economie aan de Universiteit van Warwick. Maar om te beginnen bij het begin.
What exactly is a rating agency?
Well, the traditional way that companies and countries borrowed money in the past was by going to big banks. But in the last 40 years or so, increasingly companies and countries have gone to bond markets directly, cutting out banks. And this has been to lower their cost of capital. Now, of course, when you borrow money directly in a market like that, there's an information problem. There's who are you, what do you do, how good a credit are you, how good a risk are you? And the rating agencies have basically grown enormously in that period to offer that information to investors.
The beauty of a rating is that it is simple. It is compressing a lot of information into a symbol. And an easily understood symbol. The symbol's essentially a language in the credit markets. It's the way people communicate.
Is it comparable to, grades in a school?
Yes, yes. Very similar. It's, in fact, they use similar notation.
The best rating is a triple A. And how far does it go down?
Well, of course, down to D for default. But there are many gradations. Each, you know, triple A, double A, single A, they all have a series of qualifiers to them. So, you know, one could say there's 20 or 30 different, I think that'd be fair, gradations. And of course, one can have a negative or positive outlook typically cast onto those ratings as well. So there's a whole series of signals, if you will, that the rating agencies are giving to markets about the probability of loss.
Nog een beginnersvraag. Wie maken er gebruik van de kredietbeoordelingen? We vragen het aan David Levy, tot 2004 bij Moody's hoofd van de afdeling die de Europese landen beoordeelde.
There are large numbers of funds that invest in a widely diversified portfolio of assets. So you can imagine a large bond fund which has hundreds of different issuers that it invests in. And it has limited resources. I mean, it will have some analysts who follow those portfolios, but they don't really have the time to go into detail on each one of those. So they find the ratings very useful because we are, you know, specializing in doing that. If, on the other hand, you have the extremely large players like a Goldman Sachs, they're going to rely less on the ratings because they have the resources. They have large numbers of people.
Vooral Zuid-Europa werd afgelopen zomer stevig aangepakt door de kredietbeoordelaars. Naast Griekenland kreeg Portugal de hardste klap. Moody's verlaagde de kredietbeoordeling zelfs tot junk-status. João Vieira Pereira en Pedro Santos Guerreiro, beide journalisten voor Portugese kranten, plaatsen vraagtekens bij de gang van zaken.
Moody's cut Portugal rating to four notches.
No, four notches. Yeah.
Four notches to junk. It's not just four notches. It really is like like being on the top of the building and getting down. It really started this kind of nationalistic point of view from everyone. Everyone was talking about the rating. No one could understand why was there such a huge cut when things were getting better, not getting worse. And so back then, people were really anger towards the rating agencies.
Do they really care? And rating agencies, do they really care about the countries, they really care about the people. They have the, you can say, oh, they are companies, they are doing a job, they don't have to have a soul, they don't have to have this. Well, the decision that they make affects 10 million people, 10 million people that have a life, that have expectations, and the decision is so, you know, so easy for them, just being sit in London or in New York or whatever, and say, well, let's downgrade the country. Let's not think about 10 million people. And let's do it, not looking at the fundamentals, but because we have to prove something to someone.
When I started at Moody's in 1985, there were only 12 countries in the entire world that had ratings.
In 1985, only 12?
Only 12, right. And there were very few in Europe. UK, for example, I think, and Denmark. But, you know, there was the United States, Australia, New Zealand, Canada. But it was a very small universe, all very highly rated countries.
The major categories are sovereign states, so the United States, Netherlands, France, etc. Big companies, Mobil, BP, Shell, companies like big oil companies like that, but big banks as well, and local municipalities, the city of St. Petersburg in Russia, for example, or Philadelphia in the USA. Those are three major categories. I think in more recent years also structured bonds, these bonds that were behind the subprime crisis, which pool revenues from large numbers of mortgages on residential housing.
Which basically encompasses everybody, just about, on a commercial sense, not individuals.
Why was it that before 1985, so little European countries had a credit rating from Moody's?
There were several reasons. Most of those countries' governments borrowed only in their own local market. There really was no great pressure for a rating. Many of them got rated in the 1990s, especially because it was banks in those countries that wanted to have a rating. And the policy was that in order to rate a bank, let's say from Netherlands, mm-hmm. you had to rate the central government, because there's a close relationship, clearly, between banks and the government. So, I mean, in fact, globally, the expansion of the ratings had a lot to do with the expansion of bank ratings.
Ook Nederland heeft een kredietbeoordeling. AAA maar liefst. En dan is het prettig geld lenen op de kapitaalmarkt. Vandaag gaat dat gebeuren. Nederland betaalt over het algemeen een lage rente. Maar met de eurocrisis in volle gang is het altijd een beetje spannend.
Almost 6%, right? Italians, yeah.
Ja, in totaal gaan we dus zeg maar zo'n 3 miljard nemen. Wow. Waarschijnlijk iets meer, maar dat hangt een beetje natuurlijk van de niveaus af. Dat gaat per veiling. En wij zien tussen 11 en half 12 de biedingen van onze primary deals binnenkomen. Als de veiling gesloten is, dan zullen wij gaan toewijzen. Ik zet nu het systeem aan.
Voor 13 seconden gaat het open.
Zijn we gestart, Samad?
We zijn geopend.
Oké, okay, hoe liggen de Ionia's nu?
In de 30 maart 47,5.
Ja.
En de 29 juni 44,7.
Oké. Okay. Oké, eerste. Samad?
Ja.
Eerste bits in de maart zijn binnen.
Gelijk voor 300 miljoen. De juni zijn iets lager gegaan, 44,5 nu.
Oké. Okay. We hebben natuurlijk vooraf geobserveerd hoe de markt erbij lag. En op dit moment zijn de biedingen een beetje marktconform. Voor wat we nu zien in eerste instantie.
Having a large rating agency is a profitable business.
For years, you know, until the crisis, they were, and still, their margins are higher than almost any other, just about any other industry. Moody's was probably one of the most profitable companies traded on the exchange here in the U.S. Margins higher than Google or Microsoft, or you know, I mean, really very profitable.
Originally, it was investors who paid through buying their information. But as a result of lots of merger and acquisition activity in the 60s, the rating agencies changed to issuer pays model, where issuers of bonds, that is the people who are trying to raise the money, pay a certain level of fee based on the amount of money that they're trying to raise.
Rating agencies started charging issuers for their ratings around 1970, and from that moment on, it was more up to the issuer to decide to come to the rating agency and hire the rating agency to rate their obligations. And many issuers did that because the rating helped them market their securities on the public securities market.
So it would be easier to borrow if they had a rating?
Much easier to borrow, particularly a high rating. Some entities don't pay for their ratings. The large governments do not typically pay for their rating. The U.S. doesn't pay for its bond rating, for example.
Why not?
Because they don't think they need it. But the rating agencies want to cover the U.S., they want to have the coverage, so.
Es hören nach wie vor fast alle auf diese Ratingagenturen. Sie müssen auf diese Ratingagenturen hören. Es ist in vielen Dokumenten festgelegt, es ist in vielen Bankvereinbarungen festgelegt, in Statuten festgelegt, dass sich Investmententscheidungen an den Ratings dieser Agenturen festmachen. Auch in Amerika ist es ganz elementar. Man darf am amerikanischen Kapitalmarkt nur Produkte emittieren, wenn man sich von einer in Amerika zugelassenen Ratingagentur bewerten lässt. Das gibt ihnen diese Macht, weil der amerikanische Kapitalmarkt ist für alle unverzichtbar und deshalb muss jeder, der an diese Märkte will, sich auf diese Ratingagenturen beziehen und das macht diese so mächtig.
many large investors, they simply try to game the ratings. They try to anticipate rating changes. And so ratings, you know, they're their straw man. We use that word, you know, for them. And they don't necessarily believe the ratings, but they know they have influence. Therefore, you pay attention to it. Whether or not you believe it is another thing.
In a time of crisis, you know, this is where an outfit like Moody's and S&P can have very serious effects, because when they downgrade a country or a company and it suddenly falls out of the scope of pension fund investments, there can be a lot of market movement very, very rapidly, because the pension funds are offering up their product, as it were, their holdings of these bonds on the market all at once. And this can lead to very dramatic market movements. I mean, and of course, computer software is involved in this. A lot of this is automated.
The fact is that when a company is downgraded, if it crosses certain thresholds, if the rating crosses certain thresholds, that can limit the pool of investors who can buy the bond because of the guidelines and rules that I mentioned and regulations. So, you know, there is a smaller pool of available buyers, the bond prices fall. So there's going to be a reaction just because of the fact that the ratings have been hardwired into the financial system.
De kredietbeoordelingen hebben directe gevolgen voor de beslissingen van investeerders. Dat merkte Portugal toen het land afgelopen zomer keihard werd afgewaardeerd tot junkstatus. Met als gevolg dat ook de badplaats Cascais werd afgewaardeerd. De burgemeester begreep daar niets van, want zijn stadje gaat het economisch juist voor de wind.
Já vamos ali ao palácio, só ver aqui a praça central. Isto era um antigo quartel militar, não é? Que a Câmara comprou ao Estado português e está a concessionar para fazer um hotel. E é mais um local de atração também aqui em Cascais e gerador de receita também para o município, não é? Pelo pagamento da concessão que aqui é pago pelo privado ao município de Cascais. Na altura, a informação que as agências de rating davam sobre Portugal e sobre os portugueses e sobre Cascais era uma informação de quem não conhece Portugal e não conhece Cascais. Ou seja, falavam mal de nós sem nos conhecerem. Diziam sobre nós, colocavam-nos em três letras, com uma seta para cima ou com uma seta para baixo, sem nunca conhecerem. E o povo português e o povo de Cascais é um povo trabalhador, é um povo que honra os seus compromissos, é um povo que é honesto, e se líamos os relatórios das agências, davam de nós uma ideia completamente distorcida. Quando foram as agências de rating que foram os grandes impulsionadores de toda esta crise a nível mundial? Ah, como está? Passou bem?
Está
bom?
Hã? Trabalho para a Rosa Ferreira.
Ah, sim senhora, muito bem. É um dos locais onde o preço por metro quadrado em Portugal é mais caro. O resultado para os impostos municipais é que um apartamento que é vendido neste edifício rende mais para Cascais do que 100 apartamentos rendem para municípios vizinhos, porque não estão com tão boa localização e não têm um valor de imobiliário tão alto quanto tem este edifício. Nós tínhamos uma notação que estávamos sempre ao nível da República Portuguesa. Ou seja, não pode os municípios ter uma notação de rating superior aos próprios países. E nós tínhamos elementos, dados, indicadores que nos colocavam acima da República Portuguesa, mas por via dessa regra nós tínhamos de ficar no mesmo nível da República Portuguesa, porque era um nível elevado, ou seja, tínhamos o melhor rating. Hoje nós vivemos uma guerra, é uma nova guerra, não é feita com exércitos, mas é feita com outros instrumentos. E este instrumento que tem a ver com os aspectos financeiros, do ataque à moeda, e neste caso também ao próprio euro, tem que levar a Europa a encontrar formas de ultrapassar e poder combater também estes ataques que está a sofrer nomeadamente a nível da sua moeda.
Niet alleen in Portugal kijken ze met argusogen naar de kredietbeoordelaars. Ook in Duitsland, met nog steeds een AAA-beoordeling van alle drie, stelt men inmiddels vragen bij de rol die de kredietbeoordelaars spelen in internationale economische en politieke verhoudingen.
We hebben in de laatste twee jaren immer wieder die agressieve herabstufungen der Euro-Länder gezien. Klar, viele problemen zijn hausgemacht, dat is vollkommen richtig. Von daher kan man niet zeggen, dat is alles durch diese Benotungen ausgelöst worden. Nein, viele problemen zijn hausgemacht. Aber diese problemen zijn ook anderweitig da. Diese problemen zijn ook in Großbritannien da, in den USA ganz massief, in Japan da. Und dort sehen wir, dass ganz andere Maßstäbe angesetzt werden. Und wenn ein Schiedsrichter bei unterschiedlichen Spielern völlig andere Maßstäbe ansetzt, dann muss ich mich schon fragen, welches Interesse verfolgt er. Wenn man die Verknüpfungen sich anschaut zwischen den Ratingagenturen und den großen amerikanischen Banken der Wall Street, aber auch der amerikanischen Politik, die sind sehr eng, diese Verknüpfungen. Und da stellt sich schon die Frage, ob alles, was hier passiert, wirklich neutrale Meinungsäußerung ist oder ob da nicht auch politische Einflussnahme oder eine Strategie dahinter steckt, Europa jetzt hier möglichst klein zu machen. Also das ist eine Frage, die sich hier momentan viel stellen.
Wat voor beweegredenen de kredietbeoordelaars ook mogen hebben, we moeten eerst kijken of de beoordelingen die ze maken van landen en bedrijven ook kloppen. Met andere woorden, hoe is de track record van de beoordelingen?
Late 1990s, we had the Russian crisis, Asian crisis, Enron, early 2000s. And then of course during the financial crisis, the ratings on structured finance, you know, in hindsight, were actually very, very poor, very poor ratings.
So they were pretty trustworthy and accurate, so to say, and up until 10 years ago.
I think that's fair. Even in some sectors, some could argue that they're still pretty good. Corporates have fared generally fairly well over the last, even throughout all this, except for the Enron debacle and WorldCom. But I think they have done pretty good in some sectors, other sectors very badly.
Rating agencies serve their clients, okay? Yeah. The biggest clients of rating agencies were the banks that you see here. So it's hard to say that the rating agencies did something wrong. They did their job, and their job was serving their clients. It appears that they were wrong if you don't understand their business model.
Reggie Middleton, investeerder en schrijver van een kritisch financieel weblog, keek goed naar de rol van de kredietbeoordelaars in de financiële crisis.
The rating agencies used a methodology known as HPA, HPA, which is perpetual housing appreciation, where when they price the CDOs and the derivative structures for the mortgage-backed securities back in 2005, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, they assumed a minimum perpetual appreciation of housing that would be positive forever and ever and ever. So basically, if you throw a rock up, it kept going up and up and up, and never came down. We all know how that turned out. The mere fact that you would assume perpetual house price appreciation means either you aren't very bright, which is not the case. You know, these guys are definitely not stupid. Or you had ulterior motives, and those ulterior motives weren't necessarily in line with getting a true assessment of risk. And a lot of people used to complain about Microsoft and their operating system with Internet Explorer during the dot-com days, where they say, well, when I try to open up a competing browser, it crashes. And they say there's a bug in the operating system. And then I would say, that's not a bug, it's a feature. You know, they don't want you using a computing operating system. So it's not a mistake that, in my opinion, that the rating agencies are doing. They are facilitating the desires of their clients. And their clients pay for a rating with a product that they want to bring to market. And if it needs a AAA rating, the rating agencies give it a AAA rating, by hook or by crook, basically.
In 2010, deed het Amerikaanse congres onderzoek naar de oorzaken van de financiële crisis. Ook de kredietbeoordelaars werden daarin meegenomen.
Over the last 10 years, Wall Street has engineered ever more complex financial instruments for sale to investors. Because these so-called structured finance products are so hard to understand, investors often place heavy reliance on credit ratings. to determine whether they can or should buy them. In exchange for large fees, Wall Street firms helped design the RMBS and CDO securities, worked with the credit rating agencies to obtain favorable ratings, and then sold the securities. Without credit ratings, Wall Street would have had a much harder time selling those products because each investor would have had to rely on themselves to figure them out.
They made a mistake with Lehman, they made a mistake with Bear Stearns, they made a mistake with many firms, yes.
But now, a couple of years on, they made the same mistake with MF Global.
MF Global was rated at the lowest investment grade, okay, triple B, BAA. Nevertheless, it was an investment grade. They obviously weren't aware of the trading exposure or weren't monitoring the exposures that were being built up, but with respect to Europe. And so there could have been an issue with reporting, and that's a disclosure issue with securities firms. I don't think anybody knows what's going on inside of a large securities firm here in the US. I mean, even the CEO and the CFO probably don't have a good handle of exactly what their exposures are and what's going on. Yeah. And their chief risk officer, you know, all they can do is, you know, get up and scream and say, oh my God.
But still, the rating agencies decide to continue to give them a rating.
Well, that's, you know, it's a lucrative business. You know.
De gepensioneerde advocaat Ron Grassy kreeg persoonlijk te maken met de kredietbeoordelaars. Hij kocht voor zijn pensioen obligaties van de Amerikaanse bank Lehman Brothers. Met een goede beoordeling van de rating agencies.
I had Lehman bonds, $20,000 each.
$20,000
each. The value of the two bonds, $40,000, plus the interest stream would mean that I'm out about $140,000 total on the bonds. My two bonds are rated by all three of the major rating agencies, all three as investment grade. I guess it's the myth that the ratings, like a report card, you know, if I give you an A for something or a B or an F, and that's what the ratings are. They're like a report card, and they tell you, in that case, it's the risk of default, but they tell you your investment grade or your junk bond or even worse. So I'm being told by experts that mine is up in the upper category of investment grade. This bond ended up differently because the company went under. Morning.
Good morning. Anybody email me?
No emails today for you. See, I'm a retired lawyer, and it's like I have time. And I knew what to do.
Good idea.
I knew how to do it. So I thought I could actually fight back on Wall Street, at least a segment of Wall Street, which is the rating companies. I'm suing them because, at the very least, their bonds misrated the risk factor of the bonds I purchased and alternatively, or included therein, one or the other, is that they intentionally did it. I never really gave it a lot of thought before, and I have to admit, even at that time, I didn't know that the rating agencies got paid by the issuer. I didn't frankly know anything about how it happened, but the fact that they did it, and I was pleased that they did it because there it was and I didn't have to pay anybody for it. And so started researching, and I realized that there was nothing preventing them from knowing before the bankruptcy, nothing preventing them from downgrading. And had they done it, we wouldn't be here today.
Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of trust, basically.
It is trust. I've already asked the court twice for permission to conduct limited discovery. That's discovery means depositions, interrogatories, and subpoenas, just so I could get the file on our bonds, for example, and I could find out the names of the raters or the analysts who rated my bonds so I could take their depositions, even for a couple of hours, and ask them what were they smoking when they looked over the Lehman's financial statements.
Most Most of the analysts when I was at Moody's, when I started at Moody's, had come from commercial banking. They were credit officers at a bank. They had gone through a credit training program at a commercial bank. And they tend to be, you know, I'd say sort of accountants without personality. But I'm teasing it a bit. But I think there was a reputation. The rating analysts were, you know, they're kind of slow. They're conservative. They're not the flashy Wall Street types by any stretch. They're very serious but they're, given that they had a lot of power. We know, you know, you're a junior analyst, you're sitting across the table from a CEO of a Fortune 500 company, mm-hmm. asking them tough questions, yeah. and deciding, you know, yeah. the in a certain sense the cost of their funding.
You've done that also.
Yes.
How is that?
It's actually part of the psychic rewards of being at a rating company. For years, you know, pay was not very great, you know, so you got your thrills in other ways, and part of it was, you know, the ability to travel and sit in, you know, very important situations.
Because mm-hmm. I can imagine, for example, you did Asian banks, you said, for a while?
Before and during the Asian crisis.
Yeah. I can imagine that a CEO of an Asian bank would maybe call you and say, please do not downgrade us.
Oh, I've had him say, if you downgrade us, I'll lose my job. And we say...
Did they threaten with violence? Or?
No, thank goodness. Never any real threats.
Did they bank you?
Yes, sometimes, yeah.
Kredietbeoordelaars hebben vooral bij het beoordelen van financiële instellingen in het verleden kennelijk nogal wat fouten gemaakt. Maar hoe zit dat met landen? Kan je erachter komen hoe betrouwbaar de kredietbeoordelingen van landen zijn?
One of the problems with doing that for the sovereign ratings is it's a very small sample. When you look at corporate ratings, you have a long history and a very large sample, so it's possible to arrive at more robust statistical results.
I have to say that the methods or criteria used to rate sovereigns is probably the weakest part of the rating firm's business. I mean,
why is that?
Because there are just too many parameters or variables that can influence the outcome here. I mean, in my mind, they have wrongly focused too heavily on politics rather than the economics, the fundamentals. I use the word fundamentals. The fundamentals are, how much debt do they have? What is their trajectory for growth? You know, what are their borrowing costs? Can they cover their payments? And you know, very simple, couple of simple metrics can capture this. Instead, you want to focus on, well, their political system and their parties and, you know, who's, you know, which gets to the willingness to pay, but not the ability. And I prefer if you focused on the financial strength of the sovereign rather than the politics of it. Because the politics, there's no good model for the politics. Then it's just, I say, reading tea leaves. It's just guessing. There's no real value that a rating agency can bring to that.
Once the decision was communicated, it wasn't going to be changed. So there was no point in... You know, you could complain, but there was no point in going beyond that. The Prime Minister might not understand the technical details of that process and might very well call and think maybe that the process could be reversed or changed, which was not the case. Well, and that, don't forget also, as we well understood, that there are elements of prestige involved and there are politics involved. I mean, you know, a finance minister doesn't like to be presiding over the downgrade, so to speak, right?
Yeah.
So there's more, for a politician, there's more involved than just the price of the bonds. We tried to be very sensitive to all of that, but we had a job to do.
Have you ever had calls from politicians in Europe pleading to reverse a downgrade?
After we had announced the decision,
mm-hmm.
yes, certainly. And no reason not to expect that sometimes to happen. And they might try to call
the president of Moody's or the senior, my boss, my boss's boss.
Je ne sous-estime pas les conséquences que peuvent avoir sur notre économie les agences de notation et les emballements des marchés financiers, ni non plus nos erreurs passées. Mais je le dis pour que chacun l'entende, ce ne sont ni les marchés ni les agences qui feront la politique de la France.
Robert, doen we 500 miljoen pre-hedge of zo? In die langer.
Maarten is beter gevraagd in de markt.
Oké. Okay.
Nou, we zitten nu al boven de 1 miljard op paar die Herman in de maand.
Nederland hoeft zich voorlopig geen zorgen te maken. De veiling van Nederlands schuldpapier gaat voorspoedig. Mede dankzij onze rating worden we van het geld lenen zelfs rijker.
Straks verder weg, Herman.
Oké, we zijn nu halverwege de veiling. De biedingen stromen binnen. Op dit moment zien we een prijs van 100,00. Dat wil zeggen dat we vrijwel op een rendement van 0% kunnen gaan lenen straks. Zoals het er nu naar uitziet, zal het waarschijnlijk net niet negatief in de negatieve rente kunnen uitkomen. Maar ja, goed, desalniettemin een rendement betalen op een paar miljard euro lenen op nul, dat is prima voor de staat. Tegen 0% rente, ja. Minuten nog. Ja, precies. Ik zou 500 miljoen euro niet geven. Ja.
Laatste minuut.
11:80. Ja. 11:80.
Zijn er heen.
Genoeg toewijzers.
Gaat nu sluiten, Herman.
Oké, ik wil de Ionia fixing.
47-1.
En
in de langste 44-3.
Oké. Okay. Auction closed.
Zal ik het uitprinten, Herman?
Ja. Oké, okay, de veiling is op dit moment gesloten. Alle biedingen zijn binnen. We gaan nu bepalen wat we gaan toewijzen aan de markt. En zoals het er nu naar uitziet, kunnen wij in de 3 maanden, in de kortste looptijd, op een negatief rendement gaan toewijzen. Dus een negatief rentepercentage.
Kredietbeoordelaar Standard & Poor's heeft de Spaanse kredietwaardigheid afgewaardeerd.
Meer eurolanden zouden een lagere status krijgen, zo wordt ook Oostenrijk genoemd.
Standard & Poor's heeft de kredietwaardigheid van Griekenland opnieuw naar beneden bijgesteld. En daarmee is Griekenland het laagst gewaardeerde land ter wereld.
En dan Italië. Het is snoeihard aangekomen. Daar een vernietigend oordeel van een belangrijke kredietbeoordelaar.
Kredietbeoordelaar Standard & Poor's heeft de kredietstatus van Frankrijk verlaagd, net als die van Oostenrijk. Beide landen zijn nu de AAA-status kwijt. De status van Nederland en Duitsland is niet verlaagd.
Wir sind momentan in einer weltweiten Umstrukturierung. Die Machtachsen verschieben sich. Es findet weltweit, man kann fast sagen, ein Währungs- und Wirtschaftskrieg statt um die besten Plätze für die Zeit nach der Krise. Und natürlich wird jeder große Player versuchen, in dieser Phase seine Macht auszuspielen und alle ihm zur Verfügung stehenden Mittel einzusetzen, um diese Auseinandersetzung zu gewinnen. Es wäre naiv anzunehmen, wenn die amerikanische Wirtschaftspolitik diese mächtigen Waffen, S&P, Moody's, Fitch, wenn sie die Möglichkeit hat, nicht einsetzen würde. Das wäre naiv und das wäre ja schon fast fahrlässig, wenn sie es nicht tun würden, wenn sie die Möglichkeit haben. Aber wie gesagt, Beweise gibt es dafür natürlich nicht. Das ist alles nur Spekulation und meine Meinungsäußerung.
The United States is in bad shape, but its competitors are in worse shape. as for right now. There's a triumvirate of China, the EU, China and Southeast Asia, the EU and surrounding nations, and the US. And basically, I think there's a game of chicken to see who blows up first. And whoever blows up first is going to lose their capital and flight to the other two nations, which helps them continue the policy a little further. The U.S., if the interest rates on U.S. treasuries were to increase, our debt service would be significantly higher, potentially unsustainable. But in order for it to increase, it has to be a significant reason to increase, and that capital needs to go somewhere else. Right now, even I couldn't take capital out of treasuries and put it into EU bonds because of the EU situation.
Who is more powerful in the end, a government or a rating agency?
Well, technically, the governments are the most powerful, you know, institutions on Earth. The rating agency is, as long as the rating agency is independent and is believed by investors, it can have a lot of influence.
About Europe, I would very honestly have to say that I think some of our ratings when they were first assigned were probably too high. And that is reflected in the fact that they have had to come down as a result of this crisis. If they had been not too high, I mean, it's kind of a logical conclusion in that when a rating falls dramatically in a short period of time, it's a reasonable conclusion that it was probably too high to begin with. It didn't reflect enough of the negative possibilities. So looking back on it, and I can say this now since I'm no longer employed there, but looking back on it now, I think we probably had ratings that were a little bit too high on some of the Southern European countries, given what has happened. We were too positive in some cases about the benign effects of Euro membership and didn't take sufficient account of the risks that also came from Euro membership and the structural flaws of the Eurozone.
Whenever there's a crisis, there's a huge pressure on rating agencies. And everyone asks, why did those guys give AAA yeah. to things and companies and countries that went bankrupt the day after? And so they have to show that they have courage. They have to be like instant Tarzans and to show that they really are courageous. And so they suddenly become courageous. And how? In what way? They go, this is where I'm going to be cynical. They are strong with the weak, and they are weak with the strongs.
And you quit with the rating agencies. Are those the contracts?
Yes, it's the contracts. No, é a rescisão dos contratos, não é? Porque nós somos o único país que tínhamos com a Standard & Poor's, a Fitch and the Moody's, não é? Okay. Já não é uma guerra de canhões nem de bombas, mas é através de outros instrumentos e por isso a Europa tem que encontrar mecanismos para se defender nessa guerra. Não são países que estão a atacar, numa guerra normalmente é entre países, no caso não é entre países, há novos agentes que estão envolvidos, os mercados, não é? De uma forma geral, e que têm outro tipo de armamento, e o outro tipo de armamento, neste caso, é atacando o euro. Dentro do vário armamento, o que se ficou provado é que as agências de rating serviram e estão a servir para atacar também o próprio euro. Não é uma questão de atacarem Portugal, apenas Portugal, porque hoje está aprovado que estão a atacar a nível global da Europa, não é? E, portanto, nós temos que ter armas para combater esse inimigo e temos que nos proteger, ao fim e ao cabo, desses ataques. Não é?
They still remain a force. And they still are, you know, looked upon because no one's come up with a good alternative. This is the problem. There is, you know, no one said, okay, I'll replace them, but with what? You know, so what would be better? And, you know, the brightest minds have not come up with something better so far.
Go slower, Sally. I just can't walk this fast.
Good exercise.
When Sally and I go for a walk, we're not always talking to each other. Sometimes we're just talking and enjoying the scenery, and then I start thinking about the rating agencies. And there comes a point where I'm just antsy to stop walking with her and go back to the house and start doing what I was thinking of.
You know, this is certainly a David and Goliath situation. I like to think life gets simpler when you retire, not more complicated. The opposite happened. But it's okay. I mean, I can deal with it. Mm-hmm. And keeps Ron, gives him something to do. not that he needs this much to do, but it's been an interesting process.
I'll just add one little postscript, and that is the government is not doing very much about it. The various attorney generals are not. There are no prosecutions for sending people to jail. There's been a lot of crooks. Not one crook, not one person's gone to jail. The problem is it's easy to talk yourself out of something like this. You figure, oh, those bastards, but what the heck, I got other things to do. I got to work on my golf swing or whatever. But sometimes you should put your foot down, and I think you got to pick your battles, and certainly it was easier for me because this is a legal battle and I had some idea of what to do and where to do it. But you can't always hold somebody else's coat. Sometimes you have to say, the ball somehow dropped in our lap and we're stuck with it, let's carry it.
You say, what's going to change? Will it change? The only thing that will cause it to change will be one of these lawsuits or more being successful.
Because what's going to happen?
Well, it could be very bad, depending on what the damages are assessed. It could lead, first of all, it's going to be a big hit to their reputations. Mm-hmm. Second, it could cost them money they don't have. These firms run on razor. I mean, if you look at Moody's, they have negative equity. Okay, book equity. There's no capital there. There's nothing. You know, I'm sure they got insurance.
They are so profitable.
They're profitable, but they pay it all out in dividends or buying back their shares, and you know, is what they do with it actually. So. So there isn't a big reserve fund sitting around in the ratings firms to absorb a major hit that would come from a verdict.
So it could bankrupt them.
It could. They could disappear. So that's what could change the industry.
They've committed an intentional wrongdoing, and if I'm able to prove that, they're going to owe a lot more than just what I'm out of pocket or somebody else is out of pocket, and they get punished. Their financial statements come into play, and I don't think they want that to happen, but that's what I'd like them to go through. It could be a while, but I'm not going anywhere.
Thank you for watching. For more on this subject, take a look at the playlist. You can also watch this recommended video. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel, and we'll keep you updated on our documentaries.